people want to be healthy, they have to grow organic food and eat organic food. Give more money to the farmers and less money to the doctor.
If you poisonous mean we are getting more production, but we are eating poisonous. If you organic farm, it's less production, we are eating good food, but take time if you organic farm.
It's simple. The natural always teaching us it's a recycle.
You know, we nurture the earth so it nurtures us. And there's that sort of, you know, kind of virtuous circle, which I think is what organic farming is all about.
This is where we belong, basically, the land. And this is the work we should do, or at least be connected to. Here I feel that I'm a human being, no? I'm using my limbs, using my hands, my arms, and I'm under the sun. I'm healthy, everybody's here is happy. It feels right. It feels right as a human being to be doing that.
I'm Ramesh. My full name is Ramesh Kumar. We have to work for physically. Once comes to starting the farming, you know, only physical work. We have to understood to work for that physical work. The beginning, we have a lot of struggle, a lot of problem will be there. First 3 years. After the 3 years, feed continue. After that, complete your 3 years feed. After automatic, no need to worry about that. Automatic, they will support. First of all, that water resource, first main thing. And soil condition, which is the soil text is important. Which crop is growing for the soils viable for this crop. This main thing. Planning yourself. Then you go for is better.
Good soil is it's the fundamental basis for healthy crops and healthy people who consume the healthy crops. So the basic issue is to build up a healthy soil and to maintain it.
If you do organic, it will be take like 5 years. You have to, like, green manure, you have to give green manure. And then compost also you don't buy the outside. That one only if you have to, soil is good.
If you give good compost to the plant, it come back to the man. And what you're putting into the earth and we're getting it back.
For us, it's not just a sort of collection of kind of chemicals and stuff. It's actually something living, and it has a texture, it has this bacterial life. It's, you know, there's lots of things about it which is alive.
We have to keep them living. We have to feed them for their living. By giving inorganic matters, we are killing them. So if you give organic matters, you are keeping them alive so that they can do their work in the soil.
In organic farming, it is very important, not in terms of only finances and all that, but you try to get as much as input possible from your farm. Because once you have start to get inputs from outside, you are dependent on them. And organic farming is a fundamental shift. And that shift is not only about growing healthy food by doing whatever one can see in terms of organic farming, but also it's avoiding the inputs that are coming from outside. In conventional farming, you tend to go and buy things. In organic farming, you tend to find reasons that why we are using certain things and how we can make into one farm. So there is one simple compost method, green and brown, green and brown, green and brown, green and brown. Building soil is not only about utilizing or using compost. It's also about how you maintain the life which is in the soil. And that's why there are techniques to make compost. But apart from that, there are also techniques to keep the soil healthy in terms of crop rotation, in terms of leguminous or nitrogen fixing crop or anything. Actually, when we are talking about healthy soil, it's not only about nutritional point of view or elements of nutrition. It's all about that how a soil is helping for a plant to have a healthy growth. There is a certain moments in the life of plants where they require instant energy or instant booster dose so they can grow well, especially at the time of fruiting or flowering, or when they have got disease to fight back, they need some instant or quick energy. That's where the liquid compost comes. Liquid compost in terms of composition is not very different, but the availability of different nutrients is quite different, and it's instantly available. You just need to cut the glycidial leaves that in your farm. You can plant it on the hedges, or you can have it in unutilized field or land, because it's very good to fix the nitrogen. It could be used for liquid compost, or it can go for mulch or animal feed. So generally a lot of farmers, they use glycidia. They cut glycidia leaves, they take the leaves, put it in a sack, and then it goes in water tank. Leave it for 5 days. The sugar and the soil solution will help to ferment all the material, and in 5 days this fermented composition, what we call liquid, what one can call liquid tea, is available for the plants. Biochar is something that has been used quite a lot recently in and around India. In 2011 we had a bad cyclone, Thane, and lots of forests were destroyed. There were lots of wood, and we didn't know what to do with this wood, neither the forest group nor the farm group or the farmers. So then the idea of biochar came, because we had to use this wood somewhere, and to use it efficiently, not only to burn it or use it as a for a fuel. So farmers started to make this biochar. Seeds are one of the important aspects in organic farming, also in terms of input and also in terms of how the farming is done.
Farmers need to start growing their own seeds, because the cost of seeds is very high, and buying seeds each time from a company is making the company rich and the farmer poor. And because of all the other packaged inputs that the companies push, it makes consumers sick and it spoils the soil.
Seed, we have only here one seed. Because if you go to buy outside, it's non-organic. And then a hybrid seed also they're having. Here only we are doing pure organic. Zero budget also, we don't buy any seed outside, anything. We are keeping our own seed. We know that our production given everything also. If one plant, how many, one seed, how much cost also, we know that.
There was a time when farmers never had to buy anything. Farmers never bought anything. They are the ones who bred these seeds. They are the ones who produce these seeds in their farms. All this magnificent diversity of more than 1 lakh paddy varieties, it was bred by farmers in their fields. All the varieties that we grow and conserve here in the garden are traditionally bred. So anyone can grow them and reproduce the variety. And they have been, many of the seeds that we have, we've been conserving for 10 years, 15 years, 18 years, and they breed what is called true to type. So when we, if we have a red okra and we give it to someone, it comes out as a red okra, and they can grow it and make their own seeds. We don't use any kind of pest repellents or pesticides. If a plant is affected by a disease, we would rather let it die than to artificially prop it up with some kind of an external support. Like this, the seeds that we produce from healthy plants are healthy seeds, and they have in them the qualities for being naturally healthy. And if we then combine that with a healthy soil, which is balanced in all nutrients and which is not starved of inputs and micronutrients, you'll then support that possibility in the seed. And together with a healthy ecosystem, which is biodiverse, in which predators balance the pests, that is the ideal system.
I think the starting point is realizing that there is a very delicate and complete balance in nature by itself. So all the creatures that exist in the ecosystem have a role to play. So this is the red sand boa. The locals believe that touching this snake would bring a skin disease, a sort of leprosy to you. So it's a very feared and unwanted snake. Though it is a very efficient rodent eater, it's one of the snakes that actually is loves rodents and therefore a good friend of the farmers.
There are birds also coming here. If you like, we put the maize here, the birds come, they suddenly eat and they're flying away.
Pest control, we feel that the best form of pest control is a healthy plant in a healthy soil, and also an adapted plant. So if you have plants, I mean, we do our own seed, and so that's one of the things, is that when you do your own seed, the plants get adapted to Buddha Garden. There's an adaptation sort of happening there, which is very, very specific, which means that it makes it easier for them to grow in the conditions that we have here. So that's one thing. Also, growing plants in season is really important. But we find, for instance, that if we try and grow beans during the monsoon, they get a lot of mold and fungus on them. And also aphids, and that's because of the climate. And you can spray and everything, but what we sort of prefer to do is just not to grow beans at that time. It's not a good time to grow beans, and therefore we grow something else that will grow in the rain.
Any farmer knows, any farmer who's grown a crop in different seasons knows what is the best time for a certain crop. And if you go out of that season, then you have to deal with pests. So pest is, it's our creation, because we are doing something against nature. And then if we have to control it, we have to use our intelligence and see how we can protect a plant in the initial stages.
Ripe crops for this climate is brinjal. What we grow, I tell you here. Lady's finger. And carrot is also growing here in the winter season. Sweet potatoes. People are also trying potatoes, but it is not coming good. Tapioca we can grow very good.
I have all the data in the farm. So I am using the whole year plan. I am rotation. I keep the all the time checking what crop last year growing, how much yield given, what the production here. So I am checking the data, and then same thing, seasonal crop. And then how are we going to sell it also? We can first think about, first what we're going to growing, and then how are we going to sell it? Everything we have to, last year we can compare, and then we can produce less or more. We have more things for, we need data. If we have data, we can use it. Next year, and then we can teach with also other farmers also.
I'm going traditional paddies normally. Traditional paddy giving less yield, but giving a good, no need a pest, no need nothing. Input is less input. No need to put green manure, that's all.
Food from the soil. One plant takes some food from the soil and other plant takes some other food from the soil. Like that, we are not killing the soil. We are keeping the soil balanced.
This produce nitrogen fixing from the air, the black gram. This one is sucking lot of from the soil. Lot of nutrition is sucking from the soil. So it balanced together.
I do combine crops wherever I can, leguminous crops with grains, some different kind of crops, like we have rosella with another millet, which kind of the millet grows in the first 2.5 months up and gets harvested. And the rosella is a 5-month crop which comes afterwards, grows over this kind of harvested millet. I mean, these kind of combinations you try to make as much as possible use of the land and also the combination of crop, which is good. See, here we are harvesting rice. But as you maybe see, if you look well, the rice is all flat on the field here. And that has to do with the fact that we are working with these traditional varieties, these are old varieties which were pre-Green Revolution, and these rices are kind of like they are. They are very good for organic farming, but very difficult for mechanization because they grow tall and they fall flat at the end of their maturing time.
There are lots of techniques to grow vegetables, and people have been using in many places many techniques. One way of great management for vegetable is to have a raised bed, because they are very easy to manage. And apart from that management, it's very, very easy to grow, to work. And scientifically speaking, it does many other jobs that a flat field is not able to do. For example, lots of farmers comes and they find tracts of land which is not used for anything, and they want to grow all over. But if you start making beds, you are able to contain the soil, you are able to grow a specific section of your field and to work on it gradually and to make it better. Animals have been very interesting part of organic farming since the ages, and you can say not only organic farming but any sort of farming methods, animals have been there. And in organic farming, the only difference comes that they are not seen only in the production level. Chickens don't only produce eggs for you, or cows, they are not only producing milk for you, but it also comes that, you know, how they are integrated in the farm, how they are using various farm material for their growth and also giving it back. For example, in organic farming, if the chickens or cows or goats or anything that a farmer is keeping in their farm, the first thing they try to think that, you know, they try to feed as much as possible from their own farm, because if they are not able to feed the number of cows, animals, chickens, whatever you have in your farm, from your farm, then it becomes a very difficult question, because then you are sourcing a lot of material from outside, which is most of the time which is not grown organically. And if you see animals in general, they don't require too much of animal feed. What they all require is lot of things that is available in your farm. But that's where the number comes, because in organic farming, people see that how much land they have got, what they are producing, and how many animals, number of animals they can sustain.
I want to keep indigenous cow, and I keep another 2-3 cow more to start milk production. Feed normally grazing our the wild grass system. I'm not growing for the grass with the watering, this and that, and I cannot be able to do this. It's not right time to grow. So I'm keeping outside for that our field. Our field, I have 1 acre, 50 cent there.
Local breeds are again very interesting, like local seeds, because local breeds, they are able to fight diseases, they have much more healthier life, they are able to cope with the climate, and they are very simple. So lots of farmers, they keep local breeds of cows, chicken. Of course, they don't produce too much of milk or too much of eggs, but they also don't require too much of feed. They also don't require too much of medication. They also don't require to be killed after a couple of years or 2 or 3 years.
We do emphasize a lot of fodder for the cows, so that they get really fat with fodder, which is a bit uncommon in India, very common in Europe, but in India people don't feed cows a lot of green generally. Cows, they just roam around, find what they find, but there is no emphasis on actually kind of really trying to bring that to an optimum. You grow specific grass, you specific leguminous bushes, leguminous plants, which get all cut and fed to them. and besides then the grazing part. And grazing, like I said, organized grazing is totally not common, at least not in these areas. Cows, you push them out of the gate in the morning and they come back in the evening and they have to find their own ways. It's slightly different, but we don't like this idea too much. So the whole farm is a bit of a blend of East and West here. It's some Western ideas with the Indian reality.
So it's all about a cycle, that what you grow, how much you can feed, and what you can get back. And this is about animals in organic farming. They are not only seen as a production center, they are also seen as a place where a farm interacts with them. Because if you want to produce healthy animal products, you have to have a healthy animal life for them, healthy food for them. And this is where organic farming, this is what organic farming thinks about. Organic farming is also about maintaining or keeping the farm alive as long as possible. In conventional farming, it's very interesting that people don't think about what is going to happen after them. Is the soil will be keep producing the amount what it produced, or what will happen with their water cycle, if the water will be available there for the next generation of farmers, or what will be available for the future. Of course, when we are doing farming, we are not too much keen on to looking at the future of next 100 years or 200 years. But this is where organic farming comes, because they don't want to take too much of water from the soil or to grow things that that are not from their area but require too much of water. But they try to see that how they can make a balance, the amount of water they take from the soil and how much they can protect, how much they can conserve, how they can keep the checks and balance with lots of natural inputs.
Or water is the main thing. We have to use limited water. We have to save water. Whatever you are, you have water, that water use for large area. Maximum how much you can able to do that. Save the water by drip irrigation and by sprinkler.
The interesting point in organic farming is that it's not only about production. It's not about productivity. It's not only about yield. Yield is one part of organic farming. When we are doing farming, we have to produce. But it doesn't mean that all the attention goes only for producing as much as possible. Organic farming is about keeping the nature in balance as much as possible. And if we can keep the nature in balance, the land will produce for many generations. The water will be there to farm for many generations to come. Probably the soil will be healthy for many generations, those who are going to come and do farm afterwards. Probably the land will keep producing healthy food for infinite time to come. We don't know many things in farming. And this is because since we do not encounter them, not knowing brings the disrespect to unknown.